Good afternoon. I'm Paul Janssen. I'm the director for the Center for Excellence in Local Government at Albright College, and also the treasurer for the Berks County Water and Sewer Association. Today we are hosting a session on community conversations, and our topic today is civic engagement and how to serve your community. We have four guests today. I'll go through one at a time, introductions, and then I'd like them to tell a little bit about themselves, and then we'll get into the actual meat of the program. The purpose of the program is to assist our viewers in a better understanding of civic engagement and how you can best serve your community. We have, like I said, we have four guests today, and we're live, so we encourage you to call in today. The phone number is 610-378-0426. If you have any questions, please don't hesitate to call in. My first guest on my left is Deborah Olivieri. She is the director for the Berks County Election Services. For those of you that have chosen to run for office, you might have seen her very recently. Deborah will speak to the issue of how to go through the process of elected office. And Deborah, would you please tell our viewers a little bit of how long you've been with Berks County and how long in your current position?
I started the county in 1989. I've been in my position for about 20-some years.
Outstanding. Next to Deborah is Fred Levering. Fred is the chairman of the Berks Municipal Partnership, which is a component of the Center for Excellence in Local Government. Fred will speak to the responsibility of local elected municipal offices and the opportunities to volunteer as appointed officials in local government. Fred, the Berks Municipal Partner is a unique body in CELG. How long, as well as in the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania, how long have you served the partnership, and when did you first serve in elected office, and what position was that?
Well, we established the partnership in 2005, and it's made up of, we basically have divided the county into five regions, and we have municipal officials from each of those regions trying to have a balance between boroughs, townships, and of course the city and the county. And what we do is get together to talk about issues of mutual interest. While we've learned a long time ago that while issues tend to be very localized, the solutions tend to be kind of regional. And, you know, getting input from a lot of different people helps a lot. So I've been the chair of that since its inception. Otherwise, I've been was a member of Borough Council in Wyomissing for 23 years, starting in 94, I guess. Had been on the Civil Service Commission a few years prior to that. And if you look closely at the upcoming ballot, you'll find I'm now running for mayor of Wyomissing.
Outstanding. Welcome. Next to Fred is Linda Kelleher. Linda is the city clerk for the city of Reading. Linda's going to speak on the varied opportunities to serve the city of Reading, both in elected and on the 50 appointed city boards. Linda, I think you almost last as long as the city has been a city, so why don't you tell us about your history as the clerk?
No, not quite 250 years. Feels that way sometimes. But I've been the city clerk since the city changed forms of government in 1996, so I'm at year 21.
Outstanding. Welcome. Very good. Next to Linda is James Washington. He is a former Reading School Board director and a current volunteer for a number of city boards and commissions. Jim's going to talk to us a little bit about the school board and also volunteering for boards and commissions. But why don't you give us a little background about your school board and your volunteer experiences?
Okay. Well, initially, I became involved with the school district just through some volunteer organizations, typically parent-teacher organizations, some interactivities with the teachers union, with the Reading Education Association. And I ran for office in 2008, elected in 2009, served 4 years till 2013. Additionally, I served on the Reading-Muhlenberg Career Technical Center Board, the Joint Commission, love that. It's a great way to give back. And I was also on the Reading Museum Board and Foundation, a number of nonprofits, community groups, as well as the Reading Recreation Commission. I was on the formation of the commission, which is an intergovernmental group. We do great things, and I have been the chairperson of that organization for 5 years.
So. Excellent. So I hope in this panel that we've assembled here today that we can really touch on all aspects of both elected and civic volunteering. So with that, let's get started in our questions and the topics that we have to cover. Deborah, let's start with you and governing elected officers at the municipal level. Those include supervisors of second class, council persons in boroughs, commissioners in first class townships, and finally, council persons in the city of Reading, which is a third-class city. And also there is a mayor for the city of Reading, which we all know. So those are all the various levels of elected governing bodies. So let's talk a little bit about that. Isn't the process the same for all forms of those local governments?
Well, anybody who wishes to run for office must file a petition through our office. So that's basically the first step. And our office is a great resource for people who don't know what to do. So we always suggest to give our office a call. And depending upon the office you're running for, depends upon the number of petitions, I mean, signers you must obtain for your petition. Mm-hmm. It goes everything from filing the petition to, we give out walking lists, we give out street lists to people so they can actually get qualified voters to sign their petitions. Ballot placement, we just had our ballot drawings last week. So everybody knows where their position is on the ballot, and all the information for the election is also on our website. So we have actually the ballot orders are on our website. A lot of things that people don't understand is Pennsylvania's primary, we're a close primary state, so you must be Democrat or Republican to vote in a primary, and a lot of people don't understand that. So that causes some confusion on election day. We do everything from certifying results to helping people to get elected, helping voters get elected. So there's a lot of offices that are up for election this year, and you know, we do understand everybody loves a presidential election. That's when you get your most turnout. But what voters don't realize is the local municipal elections affect you more than actually the presidential election does. So we're hoping that we get a lot of people to turn out for this primary.
One of the big issues you have when you're circulating petitions is that if you're a Republican, you have to have an actual Republican registered voter to circulate that petition, and you can only have registered Republicans sign that petition. Same thing on the Democratic side, correct?
That is correct. There is an exception to that, and that's for judges. The party doesn't affect the circulator of the petition. So, and that gets confusing. So there's different variations as to what offices can cross-file, what offices can't cross-file. You know, you have the district judge, magisterial district judge can cross-file, school boards can cross-file, judges can cross-file. Everybody else, you know, they can, so that tends to be confusing.
So cross-filing means you may be a registered Republican, but you can file as a Republican and then also file a separate petition for Democrat.
Correct.
Okay, and so when that happens, your name is on both sides of the primary ballot.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so that helps a lot to follow through with that. One other thing that I think a lot of people don't know about, I've been talking to a lot of people in this preparatory election period, you actually provide a list of street addresses and party registrations so that people know exactly who is actually registered to vote and where they live.
There's 260,000 registered electors in the county that we have. And, you know, we suggest anybody running for office is, as a candidate, you're entitled to a free walking list. So that walking list would be of the party that you were registered and want to obtain your signatures for. So that list is the best thing to use because you know that everybody on that list is registered, they're at that address, and it goes by the street and it goes by the address. So you can actually go down the block and know that so-and-so at that address is an active registered elector and the best person to get the signatures from for your
Excellent.
Petition.
Thank you. Linda, there's a couple of special requirements in the city. You want to go over a couple of those?
The only special requirements we have come from the Board of Ethics, and that's the campaign filing regulations. If you have a political action committee or you're a candidate for a city seat, not a school board or DJ or court, anything like that, only if you're running for city council, the mayor or the auditor, you need to file your statement of financial interest with the office along with your document certifying your political action committee. So and those reports need to be refiled every time you need to file a report with Debbie's office.
Excellent. Okay.
And we don't get involved in petition, signature checking, anything like that.
Okay. So, in boroughs, you run for a four-year term. I guess the city council is a four-year term. The mayor is a four-year term. Townships of the second class are kind of unusual because you run for a six-year term. And I think commissioners for first-class townships are a four-year term also. So it also matters who runs and when they run for when you can actually go for an open seat. So, excellent. Fred, can you talk a little bit about the other official elected positions in municipalities?
Well, most municipalities have a variety of different committees and commissions, some of which are appointed by the elected officials, others have actually a term. So in our borough, we have a park and shade tree commission, a planning commission, a zoning hearing board, civil service commission, and a rec board that actually are multiple year terms. Our working committees, so to speak, things like infrastructure and fire and police and finance and so on, are just appointed by council for a one-year term, but they're made up of a combination of elected officials and citizens, so we get a broader input, not just hearing from ourselves as elected officials, but also having input from a bunch of citizens. Then additionally, we have in our borough three different authorities for trash, sewer, and water, and those are five-year terms that people are appointed to.
An authority is a quasi-governmental entity, correct? Without elected office.
That's right.
Appointed office.
Yeah, they are independent. Yes.
Fred, how about tax collector?
Tax collector. We presently do. Yes, some municipalities have kind of de-emphasized that and appointed others, like a bank or something, to collect their taxes for them. School boards can elect to do that as well, but we have an elected tax collector who serves a four-year term.
Linda, there's an unusual situation in the city with the tax collector, correct?
Well, not really. Well, property taxes were required to use the county treasurer.
Right.
And then that act, I forget what the number is, from 2010, requires all municipalities in the county to use one earned income tax collector.
Right.
So we currently use BCIU.
But the city actually utilizes.
I get my B's mixed up. Yeah.
The city actually utilizes the county to issue the taxes and collect the money on property taxes.
Correct. They do property tax.
Yep.
And they send out a joint bill.
I think they only collect for the city is the only place they collect for. All the other municipalities have their own tax collectors, or they appoint other people.
I think it's a mixed lot there.
Okay. All right. I'll talk a little bit about elected auditors because they only exist in second-class townships. There's a role for citizens to run if they're interested in doing the auditing for the municipality. So in second-class townships, they have what's called a board of auditors, and they have two jobs. One is to annually audit all of the accounting for the municipality, and in second-class townships, supervisors can actually work for the township also. So their job is to set their annual salary. So the supervisors aren't voting on their own salary. So those are the two basic jobs. It also is very helpful if you happen to have auditing experience to run for the board of auditors in a second class township because you bring some expertise to how the audit is done. I've been doing some work with Upper Tuppahawken Township, and they have two CPAs that serve on their board of auditors. They only have three altogether, but two of them are CPAs, so that really helps their process. Deborah, the district justice position is also an elected position. Can you tell our viewers how many DJs there are in Berks County, and are there any special requirements to be a DJ?
Well, there are 17 magisterial district justices in the county of Berks, and there is a school that they must go to. District Justice School, and they have a good website where people can go to that website and find the information about the schooling.
Unless they're an attorney.
Yes.
Who's a member of the bar.
Bar. Right.
Then they don't need to go to the school.
So they have to go to school. Is there a test?
I honestly don't know too much about the school,
test.
I believe.
Yeah, there is a test, and in fact, the interesting thing is you can fail that test. And if you fail the test, you can't take the seat. So a lot of times district justices that aren't attorneys will take go to the school ahead of time so that they can say that they're a registered district justice. But then you also have times when people are just popular and they want to run and they run and they go to school and they don't pass. Now, I've never heard of anybody who can't pass, but in the time frame between when you are elected and you're supposed to serve, they have what they call senior district justices who will step in. They're usually retired guys. They'll step in and they'll hold that court until the district justice actually passes the school. But it's not an easy school. You have to learn some basic responsibilities. So, Linda, you want to talk about some of the things that district justices handle?
They handle traffic court, criminal arraignments, property maintenance issues. They also handle civil disputes and small claims. I believe it's under $2,500.
Excellent. So the reality is that if you commit a serious crime, the first, other than the police department, the first level of justice you're going to see is the district justice arraigning you.
Correct.
Yeah, I think in Berks County also, they keep a court open 24/7.
They
do. So if somebody gets arrested at 3 o'clock in the morning and they need to arraign them, they don't wait till 8 o'clock or 9 o'clock in the morning when that district court opens. They take them to an overnight court.
Yeah.
So they can get arraigned. So that gets taken care of. So district justice is an interesting job, and it's the very basic level of justice that we have in Pennsylvania. So yeah. I think that minimum number you were talking about, Linda, is very critical for residents to understand, because you can do a very simple lawsuit in district court as long as you're not asking for more money than the basic amount.
Right.
So, excellent. Fred is a former elected councilman, and municipal service comes with a really big salary, right?
Yeah. Yes. It's not going to throw you into a different tax bracket. as far as boroughs are concerned, I think the Pennsylvania Borough Code allows paying up to as high as $1,200 a year. Our borough doesn't pay anything, which many people say you're getting paid what you're worth, but you know, it's still, it's you don't get involved in these things because they're lucrative. I mean, in all honesty, people should get involved in municipal government because it's the right thing to do. I mean, Debbie alluded to registration. We're what, say 260,000, but there's 400,000 people in Berks County. Now, some of them aren't old enough to vote, but still not everybody is eligible to vote because they're not registered, and then they the turnout numbers sometimes are pretty awful. So people complain about things. This is an opportunity to actually do something, you know, get involved and not just sit around your office drinking coffee complaining about how things are done, but getting involved in doing something about it. So I think it's a very important thing. It ought to be a requirement that people are registered. If obviously you can't, but I'd love to see a higher participation, much higher turnouts. These are important things, as you alluded to. People get all cranked up about the presidential elections, but at the municipal level, there's an awful lot that goes on. It affects, you know, public safety, fire and police, and picking up trash, and all those things that we take for granted. Somebody's got to organize that stuff. It's really very, very important work.
I had a question on the turnout issue. You hear a lot about the fact that our turnout levels are low, and then there's statements made about people that are registered in multiple places for multiple reasons. You know, when I was out there and I had the walking list and was walking about and checking with people, and you'd come upon people that weren't at the location that had been noted that they were there. And I didn't recall returning the list back and saying, hey, this individual no longer resides here. How do the registration rolls get updated, and how does that affect the turnout numbers? Because when I moved from New York back here, I didn't unregister in New York and then register here. I was still registered there for whatever amount of time. And I'm just curious about incidences when people just move away and how that affects those percentages.
Unless a voter notifies us that they moved mm-hmm. to another state and wish to be removed from the rolls, we really don't know. We do a mailing once a year where the voter rolls are matched up to the post office, and anybody who did a change of address would receive a card from us. And that card, if it comes back undeliverable, that means they're placed on an inactive status. We can't confirm that address. So if an inactive person goes to vote on election day, they're gonna have to fill out an affirmation affirming that either one, they didn't move, or two, they did move. And they'll need to update their addresses. If it's within the county, it's easy to track. If it's within Pennsylvania, we're good, because you got every county in Pennsylvania on a statewide system. It's when a voter moves to a different state, unless we're notified, we can't remove them from the rolls. But we get records from Department of Health. that we remove people from. So there are mandated updates that we have to do in order to keep the roles updated. There is forms on our site, on our website, if you move to another state to remove them. The problem too is if we get a notice from another state that so-and-so registered there, I need a signature to remove that person. I just can't remove them. So we'll mail them an address verification notice to confirm that they are now registered in a different state. So everything we do is based upon a signature.
Okay.
What happens if they've changed, Jim moves from New York to Reading, he changes his driver's license to Reading. Mm-hmm. Does that notify?
PennDOT? PennDOT will notify us.
Well, I guess my point was, say I moved from Pennsylvania to New York, mm-hmm. I didn't notify you, I don't respond and sign, how long do I remain registered here in Pennsylvania?
As you will remain registered here as long as you are an active resident of Berks County. We don't know when people are registered in other states. Okay. It's up to that person. You really shouldn't be registered in two different places, two different states. So you should notify the state that you registered and okay. change your information.
Thank you. Mm-hmm.
Jim, coming back to the issue of compensation, I hear Ryan Missy doesn't pay their council people, but you can get paid. The school board, that must be very lucrative.
It's rewarding, but not lucrative. Yeah. What's interesting, because school boards are made up in a variety of places in different manners, and some are compensated, some are professional. When people come to a board meeting, especially at budget time, and you're talking about cuts and different things, I've had individuals stand up in front of you and say, your pay should be withheld and all those things, and it's kind of humorous. But it's a lot of time. It has its rewards, but there is no compensation.
There's no compensation for school board anywhere in Pennsylvania.
All right.
In other states, I think there is, but not in Pennsylvania.
Right.
So it's a labor of love if you want to do it, as it is in Wyomissing. So, Linda, I mean, there is some positions elected in the city that have pay, but most are not very lucrative either.
No. The charter sets the salaries for the mayor, the elected auditor, and the seven council members. Six district councilors get paid $5,000 a year. The council president gets $500 more, so he gets $5,500. They're actually one of the lowest paid city councils in third class cities in Pennsylvania. Mm-hmm. The mayor earns, I think it's $72,600, and the auditor, I believe, is $57,000.
Right.
So in council, after the charter sets that initial salary range, the council can increase that or decrease that by ordinance.
Right.
So any change wouldn't apply to the sitting council, it would only apply to the new incomings.
So for city council, we're looking at minor vacation pay. That's about what you get for working an entire year.
Right, and they've considered increasing their compensation twice over the last 21 years and rejected it both times.
Yeah, absolutely. We're looking at a situation where you may not get paid anything, or you may get paid $1,200, as Fred was talking about. I know over my career, council people have tried to track how much time they spend, and it can be very debilitating if you really look at it, because what you find out is you're getting paid 10 or 15 cents an hour for all the work you do.
Yeah, it's best just not to think about it.
Yeah, just enjoy the service that you do.
Yeah.
I do think we ought to talk a little bit about the fact that when you are in elected office, you have responsibilities you have to do. You have to attend meetings and you have to make decisions. But there's a lot of other responsibilities. I'm sure with the school board and Fred with council jobs, you're getting calls all the time. People stop you in the grocery store. There's a lot of other time that has to be invested. And then other work has to be done in order to prepare yourself to make a decision. So,
well, that's true. I mean, and as I said previously, that we're the ones closest to the people. Nobody really knows what goes on in Washington, and not sure about Harrisburg, but they know where I live. The old joke is we're the municipal people are the ones that are within nose punching distance of the public.
Excellent, Jim. You have any comment about that from the school board?
In the school board, there was a lot of material to read. at the time that I served, we had a lot of subcommittees. So you might have served on extracurricular or finance. The district is huge. The budget's $240 million. There's a capital budget that's probably 60 or 70. So to make decisions in support of the superintendent and on behalf of the administration, you know, when your contracts are being presented to you, there was a lot of information to digest. So it was a lot of time.
Yeah, there's a lot of people who think you show up twice a month for a two-hour meeting, and that's the job, and it really isn't the job. Deborah, when you decide to run for local government, whether it's school board or city council, whatever, there's got to be 10 or 15 requirements to actually run for that position, right?
Well, there's residency.
And?
I'm a registered voter.
And? That's it.
That's it.
That's the qualifications. Mm-hmm. You need to be registered to vote, and you need to be a resident for, in most cases, a year.
In most cases, it's a year.
Right. Correct. So that's all you have to be in order to run for elected office. So, you know, if you're not registered, get registered. And if you've moved into the area recently, you have to wait a year. Otherwise, you're eligible to run for elected office. So the reason why I'm saying that is there's very little reasons why you can't run for office other than if you choose not to be registered to vote or you've just moved in. Fred, I'm going to ask you first. What are some of the traits that would make somebody who's running for public office an effective local government official, whether it's school board or it's...
I think a lot of public perception is that people involved in elected office therefore are politicians and therefore speak all the time. And that's the biggest mistake you can make. You got to be a good listener. You got to be able to really listen and listen well. And the other thing is there are always two sides to every story. And you don't ever want to become the person that agrees with the last person they spoke to. You got to make sure that you, when somebody comes to you with an issue, your correct response ought to be, interesting, let me look into it, I'll get back to you, as opposed to instant analysis, that you've got to make sure that you hear the other side of the story. There's always more to it than you're initially told. Right. And you got to take it in, think it through, and then recognize what are the ramifications of this decision. You know, what else is it going to affect? What kind of a precedent do you establish or whatever? So listen.
Jim, do you have anything to add to that?
My only thing that I would ever tell anybody is to not vote on consensus. And by that I mean your vote should be your vote based on the information that you have and your opinion of the information that's been presented to you. You know, I held to for 4 years that no one could contact me to ask me what my vote was for that evening for a general election, general meeting. And very quickly they understood that there was no point to call me to ask me that because my reasons for making my vote were based on the information that was presented to me by whoever was presenting me that information. And I felt good every day when I left knowing that was the case. And I'm disappointed when, and this is my only personal opinion, that decisions are made sometimes in consensus. I just think that's a...
That's very well said. I mean, I've always argued that, in our case, we have 7 members of council, and if everybody thought alike, then 6 of them aren't necessary. I mean, you know, having a debate, talking it back and forth, listening to the other points of view and then reaching a decision is the right thing, and I couldn't agree with you more.
Thank you.
Both of you talked about not reaching a decision before you hear the issues and so on. In my career, working as a chief executive officer in municipalities, some of my frustrations with elected officials is they just can't make a decision, and that's as debilitating as forming an opinion before you have all the information. So I think that, you know, one of the points we want to make today is if you're going to run for elected office, you've got to be prepared to make decisions, good, bad, or indifferent, tough decisions. But when the time comes, it's important that a vote is cast either yes or no, so that issues can be resolved and move forward. So I want to remind everybody that we are live now, and we're going to take a quick break. Recapture where we are, and that you can call in at 610-378-5000. 0426 if you'd like to ask any one of us a question about the topic that we're talking about today. Thank you. We'll be right back. Okay, welcome back. We are now moving on to our second segment, but while we were at break, we talked about whether we covered everything, and one of the issues that came up that we want to talk a little bit about is if you are running in the primary in the general election and there isn't somebody running on the other side, whether you're Democrat or Republican, vice versa, what is the effect of write-in ballots that occur there? And so I'd like to ask Deborah to cover that topic a little bit, and then we can all add in a little bit.
If there's nobody running, say I'm a registered Democrat, and I go into the voting booth and I see nobody running under that ticket, you can actually write somebody's name in. We get Mickey Mouse, we get Donald Ducks, we get, and they would actually be elected if they were legitimate voters. But you can write someone's name in. You know, it takes at least a minimum amount of signatures as a petition. So if I'm a borough council, I need at least 10 on a petition, so I need at least 10 write-in votes, but always one more than anybody else would get, depending upon what the vote fours are. Now, there's a whole process with write-ins. They're not as easy. You just don't appear on the ballot. The person has to petition those votes to accumulate them. If the variations are different, the only way I can count them is if you are registered, as you are registered. So if you're registered as Christopher Smith and someone writes in Chris Smith, I'm not going to count that.
Right.
You have to do a petition to accumulate those variations. And so there is a lot of work. And some people think, okay, I got write-ins now. I'm going to appear on the November ballot. And you're not. You have to accumulate them. You have to claim those write-in votes.
How many different variations can you claim?
Well, you can claim as many as you want,
okay.
As long as they are you. The board won't accept first names only or
right.
last names only, because there are usually people in that municipality, you know, with this same first or last name.
Yep. I was involved in a municipality that had a write-in, and the candidate doing the write-in actually issued stamps. It was a paper ballot system. And they issued stamps, and so mm-hmm. you could walk in and just stamp, and that's one way to know that you're going to get the right signature, name, or spelling for the name so that it can occur. But there's a whole lot that goes into a write-in campaign.
We normally get, and it's scary, at least 8,000 write-in votes in a municipal election, and they have to be hand-typed. So you have myself and my assistant typing all these write-ins in an Excel spreadsheet, so it's a lot of work. Stickers, we don't encourage, because they can jam that machine. What people don't realize is that tape in the back twirls. So, and that sticker's not placed correctly, it will jam that machine, and then to unjam it, that vote's actually canceled.
It's lost, yeah.
Yes.
Absolutely. Cool. Excellent. Anybody else have anything to add to that? Okay. Again, we are live, so your phone number to call in if you have any questions is 610-378-0426. Again, 610-378-0426. 0246. So there's an awful lot of opportunities. Jim, you talked about some of the things you were involved in. There's a lot of opportunities for people to get involved in just volunteering. So let's talk a little bit through that. Things like Planning Commission, Zoning Hearing Board. Fred, you want to talk a little bit about those two bodies?
Well, Planning Commission is appointed by the elected officials, and it's a term, as I said earlier, 4 years in our case. And they would take a look at people that want to build things. So your first job is to figure out whether it complies with the appropriate zoning and so on, and then whether it meets the land development requirements of water runoff and all sorts of other things. So a planning commission would study a plan for somebody that wants to make take a vacant piece of land and develop it in some way or change an existing property. Zoning hearing board is a reflection of the fact that every municipality has zoning laws, and zoning is set up by the elected officials. If you make a change to zoning, you have to have a public hearing and so on. But once the zoning is in place, and then people will begin to use that zoning for however they wish to utilize their particular property. If they find that they want to do something that, that does not comply with the written zoning, then you would ask for a variance. A variance is heard by a zoning hearing board. A zoning hearing board is an entirely independent body. They are appointed by the elected officials, but they don't answer to us. The zoning hearing board has their own solicitor. Their hearings are done with a stenographer, so there's a public record and so on. There are fees to that that are charged to the applicant. But basically, the zoning hearing board would consider what the applicant wishes to do and then issue a ruling of some sort. If the applicant doesn't like what the zoning hearing board had to say, your appeal is not to the borough or the township or the city. Right. Your appeal is to the Court of Common Pleas. And if you don't like what the Court of Common Pleas said, you can go to the state courts and appeal it further.
Yep.
Which happens.
We have this law in Pennsylvania called the Sunshine Law, which means that you have to deliberate in public. And so when you want to talk about a decision, all that discussion has to be in public, unless you're getting background information or educational preparation for a decision. The only exception in that law is the Zoning Hearing Board. They are allowed to talk about the decision process till they get to their actual decision. Right. In private, and nobody's allowed to know what they're talking about unless they want to make it public what they're talking about, until they make their decision. And then the moment they make their decision, that's announced in public, and then it becomes something you can see. So that's the only body that is completely in the deliberation process, completely independent of public sunshine.
I should add, Paul, that to be considered for appointment to either the Zoning Hearing Board or a Planning Commission, you need to be a resident of that particular municipality.
And one other area that the Planning Commission gets involved in is comprehensive planning. So when you want to develop a site, typically the zoning for that community is reflective of the comprehensive plan. And the Planning Commission is the base organization that reviews the comprehensive plan and updates it and actually can change the way a municipality is going to look because they want that, they want it to look different. They start with a comprehensive plan.
I think we might want to also note that this sounds complicated and it shouldn't scare anybody off because there is support available. You know, first of all, just the body itself talks to each other and, you know, brings people up to speed and so on. But as Deborah had alluded to with the district justices having to go to school for that particular office, there are opportunities for people that want to serve in these other capacities, which is one of the things that the center does, of course. Our Center for Excellence in Local Government here, which is a very, very unique and well-regarded organization in not only local governing circles but across the state, offers a tremendous amount of workshops and classes on those kind of specific things about helping people get prepared to be a good participant in zoning hearing matters or planning commission matters or whatever.
Yeah, that's a good point, Fred. You know, a lot of people will look at the master planner series that we have at the center. And that's three different classes of 3 hours for zoning, for subdivision land development, and for community planning. And so when you finish that series, you have 27 hours of education in what you're doing there. A lot of people will come and take it after they get appointed. We also have a lot of people who want to be appointed, and they take it ahead of time just so that they have that background. And then we have a 15-hour program called the Advanced Master Planner Program, which also provides planning topics on a deeper scale or a more specific topic kind of issue.
And then the land use forums that you do that are quite excellent.
Linda is probably our most consistent attendee at our land use forums.
I love land use.
And it's really easy for her. She walks down from College Heights on Saturday mornings, and it's a 5-hour training period, and it's a very short walk for her. But she has been to all five that I've been with the center on, and so she's a regular attendee for our, it's called the Pennsylvania Land Use Institute, and we do 2 hours of review of breaking court cases and laws that affect planning and zoning. And then we usually have two or three very detailed topics that we present of emerging issues that are in planning.
The other thing that you should have heard here is Linda Kelleher, who got involved in city government right after William Penn established the Commonwealth, still goes to classes.
That's right.
And there's
you can never stop learning.
That's exactly the point.
Well, and she comes to our municipal secretaries. In all forms of government in Pennsylvania, there is a person. The title is secretary, and people say, well, she knows how to do stenography or answer phones or whatever, but it's like a corporate secretary, and so that job is a very responsible position, and you really are responsible for all the legal filings and so on for the municipality. In the city, it's called a city clerk. The city clerk works for, and correct me if I'm wrong, you work for city council.
Correct.
And you keep all the legal records of the city, and you're responsible personally to make sure all that's filed. So when you hear the term municipal secretary, it's a completely different position than what you think.
Yeah, so people always assume that the municipal secretary is always a female, too. I'm only the second female in the position since William Penn.
Excellent. How do you get on a planning commission, Linda or Fred? How does that happen?
Well, it's an appointment.
Yeah, it's an appointment.
And it's a appointment that's then confirmed by the governing body, by the council or the supervisors.
So it's a very important position, planning commission and zoning hearing board. But you have to make people know that you want to do that position and perhaps prepare yourself for it. But the only way you get there is to I guess in the city, the mayor can nominate somebody, or does council control how that appointment is done?
Technically, council controls some, the mayor controls others, but the way we do things like one big happy family, and we take the mayor's recommendation on all.
I don't think I've ever heard anybody describe Reading government as a big happy family before.
Well,
the other thing that I think has some relevance is that people will many times get involved in a committee or a commission and eventually then run for the elected official. I mean, it's kind of a farm system to come up and end up in one of the elected positions.
But people need to understand, too, that life happens. So if they're going to sign on for the parking authority for a 5-year term, something may change in their life that causes them to need to resign after 2 years. And we understand that life happens. Mm-hmm. So you should never say, I can't do it because this might happen.
Okay.
Recruitment, like, that's one thing I know council and myself and others are constantly doing. I'm constantly harassing people to fill, you know, the various openings we always have.
Well, let's talk a little bit about that. That's an important thing. I guess it was 3 years ago, maybe 4 years ago, there was a ballot initiative to allow for citizens to serve on more than one of the commissions and committees.
Right. The charter restricts people from serving on more than one.
Right.
And that doesn't apply to authorities. Only boards and commissions.
Right. And that was the one initiative out of six that lost.
Yeah.
Surprisingly, I think Reading is pretty prideful with their citizens about really focusing on one job and staying on that job and not serving four or five different committees. But that does make it difficult because there's quite a few.
Unfortunately,
I want to see everyone who voted no. I want to have their application on my desk by tomorrow, well, Friday.
So let's talk about some of these citizen committees that are in the city of Reading. How many do we have?
You would think that with the number of individuals in the city, that would be easy to fill all the authorities and commissions and boards that exist. But to a large degree, a lot of the same individuals serve in a lot of capacities. And that initiative would have allowed for them to serve in multiple areas in it. And I mean, I know I've resigned from, you know, TRIZ in order to serve on the Rec Commission and would have done both, you know, was not permitted. So
it's not unique to the city. Deb, how many empty positions are there?
There's a lot throughout the
county.
School boards
and elected officials and you have a, you know, a council of seven and there's only five people running or something like that.
Right, right.
And people don't realize if you don't get elected to that full term, they have to list that as a short term. So for council, if no one gets elected or if they appoint them, I now have a 2-year short term that's going to appear the next municipal election. So it just keeps creating, you know, additional offices and stuff that have to be placed on the ballot that you're not getting people to run for. It's interesting when people come into our office and they're talking like why they're running. You know, their heart is into it. They want to make the school district better. They want to make the municipality better. And your heart really does have to be into it, and you have to really care about your municipal government in order to run for these offices.
I think we could probably safely say too that there are very few committees, commissions, or boards that you serve on that the compensation is really good also. Mm-hmm. So it's very similar to running for elected office. A lot of it is just an interest in what you're doing and working.
But you also have to know what the heck you're running for. You know, people get under the ether of watching the cable TV shows and think that I'm going to get elected to some municipal position and have something to say about you know, the national budget or you know, healthcare or something. I mean, that doesn't happen. You're not going to be asked your opinion on those things.
Right.
Jim, you serve on the City Recreation Board?
I just ended at the end of 2016.
So tell me about the kind of time commitment you had when you did that.
That was probably the easiest because we had an executive director and a committed full-time staff that was focused about youth and adult recreation all the time. And so, but as chairperson, I was involved in a lot of things. I attended a lot of meetings. You know, you were involved in a lot of different stuff. So that commitment was not nearly as arduous as the school district's time. The school district was probably an additional, I'd say another 40 hours a month of committed time to do that, you know.
It better be a hobby or you're not going to have a hobby.
Yeah, and it's you know, it's, one term ends up being plenty. You can get burnt out, so.
Excellent. Linda, I think you have a graphic, but you have how many boards and commissions?
There's about 50.
So there's about 50 for the city of Reading.
Right.
And I'm certain they're not single person boards, so.
No, the smallest board is 3. The largest is Historical Architectural Review Board. I believe that's 13.
Okay.
And a number of them need volunteers. We need people. There's always an updated list on where the openings are on the website, and you can easily find on the website a description of what the positions are, and you can always call my office if you want more information.
So pretty much in all of those, you have to be a resident of the city.
Right. The charter does give council the out. Like if there are trades boards, there's you know, plumbing, HVAC, that type of thing. There you need to have a license. So first we look within the boundaries of the city, and if we can't locate anyone within a reasonable period of time, then we approach the trades boards and ask them for some outreach and recommendations. So there they might choose someone who doesn't live in the city but works in the city.
Okay.
And excellent. That applies to other places too, like the Animal Control Board, for example, needs a veterinarian. So we may not be able to find a veterinarian who lives in Reading, so then we need to look outside.
You mentioned the Historical Architectural Review Board. There are non-residents eligible to be appointed to that board also, right?
Right, because there are some specialties there, like an architect, a realtor.
Yeah, so there are exceptions to resident rules for certain committees and commissions and boards.
Right, the only place there's no exception is the Charter Board and the Board of Ethics.
Okay.
Those, you must be a city resident. And we have a desperate need for people in those spots.
Why don't you state that clearly in case anybody sees that. What are you looking for?
We have two openings on the Board of Ethics, and that's a board of five. And your only requirement is to be a city resident. That's it.
Okay.
Charter Board, well, they hear violations of the ethics code, of course. Okay. And that includes the campaign contribution portion. The Charter Board just hears complaints on violations of, or alleged violations of the charter. They currently have only two of five members, so they can't even meet a quorum. Most of both the Charter Board and the Ethics Board, they don't necessarily need to meet monthly. They only need to meet if there's a complaint or a request for an advisory opinion. So there, you're not even looking for a dedicated amount of time, like 30 hours a month. You're, you know, really talking about a minimal time contribution most times.
Excellent.
If you have a commission that doesn't have enough to make a quorum and they got to make a decision, what happens?
They can't.
So it doesn't get kicked up to a court or something like that?
No.
Wow.
No. And it's tough because there are instances where commissions are making decisions. Our commission right now is while it's 11 members and it currently may only have...
We have two openings.
Right. So you're at nine. If you need to have at least a 5-4 decision, you need to have at least six present in order to have a meeting. And it can be a challenge sometimes to even just have a meeting. To be able to vote on something, and the votes could be to, you know, approve a contract or, you know, increase a pay or to do something, or things that become, you know, you can do things retroactively, but it's not a good way to operate.
Right. So, we've recently done a push out through the Bar Association and the Chamber of Commerce to try to attract applicants.
Excellent.
And we also restarted our quarterly newsletter and started advertising the need for boards, authorities, and commissions there too.
That's a good way to reach out to the citizens too. They know that you're trying to communicate with them, so that's very good. One board that can function without a quorum is the Zoning Hearing Board. In Pennsylvania, typically a Zoning Hearing Board has three members, although I think it can have five, and you can also have alternates to it. But there is a legislated period of time that the Zoning Hearing Board has to make a decision.
Right.
So you can go down to one member, and that member is then called a zoning hearing officer. They hear the case, they make the decision, and that's what you get. And so they are allowed to do that. That's the one, and it's a quasi-judicial board, but that's the one board that can meet in order to meet that time frame and make it happen. So it's an interesting criteria. We also have in Pennsylvania, in every form of government we have, with the exception of second-class townships, we have a civil service board. Fred, you said you started working for that board. What does a civil service board do?
Well, in our case, it was tasked with the hiring of folks that would be subject to civil service, which would be basically police. And now we have a professional firefighting group as well. Mm-hmm. We actually conducted interviews and so on. And then they kind of recommended we change the rules, where now our Civil Service Commission establishes the rules and the criteria for testing and whatever it might take, but the actual interviews of the candidates for instance a police officer position are now held by a group of policemen that know the business and know what they're looking for, and then they make a recommendation to the council that then in turn will actually make the hiring. And we have a ranked listing of, if there were whatever, you know, 20 applicants, and we give them a test, and 15 of them pass the test, so they're eligible, and then we do the interviews, and we end up with we usually will have a couple of people for each opening that's available, and then that list is good for 18 months, that if we need to use it again, we can, but we no longer actually conduct the interviews.
Yeah, so I think the issue with the civil service now not doing the interviews is that if somebody claims that they were discriminated on whatever level, whether the person didn't do the stopwatch right or what when they're running their mile or whatever, the appeal goes to the Civil Service Commission. And so the Civil Service Commission can't be the person holding the stopwatch and then defending themselves. There's also a second part of civil service, and that's a discipline board, if the contract responsibility allows for that to occur. Some places they don't. They go to arbitration, they go independently, they go to court, whatever. But they could also be the discipline board for anybody who's affected by civil service. So if you're interested in, if your interest is in really making sure that you keep an independent review of how people are hired and how they are scored so that you get your best candidates going, civil service is an interesting challenge. Requires a lot of time, as Fred said, when you're developing the list, you have to proctor the exams, you have to proctor the oral interviews, you have to proctor the physical tests. And usually all civil service requirements have those three parts. So there's a lot of time commitment when that's happening, but then when the list is done, you can kind of sit back unless you have a big discipline case that you have to do. So interesting process. We're getting close to the end of time. I want to go down the line and just see if you all have anything you want to add in terms of, you know, our whole purpose today is to talk to people about what's required to be an elected office or what's required to serve your community for civic engagement. So, Jim, why don't we start with you? Do you have anything you want to add?
I don't have anything to add as far as, something that's a requirement, although, you know, what I would like to see, and, you know, it's a wish, is that school board would become a non-party elected position, that there not be a designation of Democrat or Republican. It just seems kind of counterintuitive to have to declare a party in order to run for something that the decisions shouldn't have party affiliations to do with. So that would be, you know, my hope for something in the future as relates to school board service. Those
judges are kind of the same.
Yeah.
Linda, do you have anything you want to add?
Oh, just run for office, vote, and apply for my board's authorities and commissions.
Excellent.
And here, Jim, I'll give you the list, all right, and you can look it over.
But I think we would be doing the position an injustice if we didn't note that in boroughs, when there is a mayor, the mayor's responsibility is to either make or break ties for council. So if it's a 3-3 vote, they can make it a 4-3 vote, or if it is a 4-3 vote, they can cast a vote to make it a tie so the decision doesn't get done. So anyway, that's an important thing. Fred, do you have anything you want to add?
Get registered, get registered, get registered.
Excellent. Deborah?
Come out and vote. May's the primary.
Well, thank you very much. We've reached the end of our allotted time. We hope that you enjoyed the show, and we hope maybe that we have a couple people out there that might make the decision to either run for office or volunteer for office. Thank you very much, and appreciate all of your participation in this panel today.